The thing is that now, you know, what do we mean when we even use the word India? You know, who is India? The growth rate did gallop, but it came at such a cost. I mean, very many million were pushed into the middle class, but many more were pushed into the underclass, away from the light. So we don't know that story. It's not told.
The intricate way in which it's structured is not so much because of my screenplay writing. It's much more because of my training as an architect. You know, I see the bones of the story very clearly, and I took 4 years to write this book because of that.
Arundhati Roy's career choices or body of work is quite diverse. She has never confined herself to one particular profession. She is someone who has always explored multiple areas of her interest. Being a political activist, environmentalist, author, screenwriter, architect, and even a dance instructor for a brief period in her life, she is a true example of someone who thrived despite multiple passions and interests.
You know, the world is very busy classifying and codifying and putting people into silos, and it's especially today, you know, when majoritarianism is on the rise, it's our job to be unpopular. You know, it's our job to stand alone and say what we really think, not as activists but as writers.
There have been innumerable instances where people criticized Roy, saying she is pessimistic, delusional, and even is misrepresenting the country. Despite the criticism, one thing that has always been her priority was to be involved in the conversations relating to the politics of the country, for it involves people. She has used countless platforms to talk about her opinions on issues like Narmada Dam Project, Kashmiri separatism, Adivasi land rights in Kerala.
I'm here and talk about justice. It is justice for everybody.
With her views on majoritarianism, Roy gracefully presents a very interesting point of how it is important to not keep the lawmakers or the decision makers confined to one fixed group. It is with discussion and accumulating the opinions of various groups and communities involved that we can come up with better policies. Ironically, such an important point of view, where she is actually talking about inclusion, has been criticized as anti-national. She is someone who has voiced her opinion not just in India but also on various international platforms.
Us who stand here and talk about there being a place for everybody, whether there is a minority, whether it's an ethnic minority or a religious minority or minority in terms of caste, we do not believe in majoritarianism.
Another impressive thing about Roy is her constructive criticism. Being critical and analyzing the most important policies and amendments is something that everyone needs to take away from her essays and writings. She points out the most unnoticed and unspoken yet important elements about capitalism, economic condition of the country, and perception management by corporates.
We need a new imagination. Perhaps it begins with forcing capitalism to tolerate a non-capitalist society in its midst, so that it accepts the fact that it can't have everything.
Arundhati Roy has, is, and will keep voicing her opinions about the problems of the nation that matter, about the oppressed and the minorities. She has proven time and again that isolation, unbiased criticism, suppression shouldn't stop one from doing what they believe in. Unlike a lot of so-called activists and nationalists today, she is a rebel with a very profound cause.
I never accept that added profession of being an activist, because I think that reduces what writers used to be. All writers, not all writers, but many writers write about the world they live in without needing to be called activists. That's a very new word, and that word has been added on because the idea of what a writer is in the world today has been reduced into a commodity. You know, you're supposed to be an entertainer who lives between literature festivals and bestseller lists or something.